طابت نفسي بنور من فؤادي حينما رددت يا رب العباد.
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. I welcome all of you once again to part 2 of the story of Ka'ab Ibn Ashraf. We continue from where we left, but before we dwell more into the topic, we need to understand the Treaty of Madina here, also commonly called as the Constitution of Madina or the Charter of Madina. Now remember, during the pre-Islamic times or during the days of Jahiliyyah, the tribes of Medina were very disorganized. What I mean here by disorganized is that there were a lot of civil wars that were going amongst the tribes in Medina. So when Rasulullah ﷺ migrated from Makkah to Medina, he saw that. Remember, Rasulullah ﷺ was not just sent to Muslims. He was sent to the whole of humankind. So this treaty, he was successful in ending the long-running civil wars that were going amongst the tribes. That's number one. Number two, he brought all of them together on a common platform. Three, this treaty essentially created a multi-religious state in Medina. So now you were able to practice your religion without harming or dishonoring or disgracing any other religion. With Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam as their chief arbitrator to settle any disputes amongst them. This treaty was favoring the likes of Banu Nadir, was favoring the likes of Ka'ab ibn al-Ashraf, was favoring one and all, was favoring every tribe. Why? Because this treaty not only gave them their religious rights, but it gave them their civil and business rights. It gave them the safety and security. All of the tribes, including Ka'ab ibn al-Ashraf, were signatories to this treaty. And they had vowed and promised to protect one another from any internal or external aggressors. This treaty also explicitly mentioned and made it very clear that anyone who is in breach of this treaty was to be held legally liable and shall be punished for his offense. Banu Nadir and Ka'ab in particular were very resentful towards Muslims. Ka'ab's enmity towards Islam made him do things that were in serious breach of the constitution of Medina. If you remember the previous video, the part one of the story, we said that Ka'ab was a famous poet. So he wrote poems dishonoring and humiliating Muslims for a very long period of time. He even undertook a secret expedition to Makkah to meet Quraysh to incite them to fight war against Muslims. Now Quraysh had recently lost the Battle of Badr. So they were waiting for an excuse to fight Muslims again. And here Ka'ab is writing poems eulogizing Quraysh to wage war against the Muslims. So if you see, he's crossing all boundaries. He's going way beyond the breaching of the constitution of Medina. So basically he's declaring a war against his very own state. Now, when he returns back to Medina, he stoops further low, where he writes sexual and illicit and sensual poems against Muslim women. This shows he has zero respect for women. Now, his crimes don't stop here. He is involved in conspiracies to assassinate Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Look in his head. He's dreaming of assassinating the Rasul of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I mean, why on earth would somebody do that? I mean, Shaitan is out on a prey and Ka'ab was his easy prey. Or maybe Ka'ab's ego got the better of him. But nonetheless, Ka'ab's crimes in itself were serious enough, and they were breaching the constitution or the charter or the treaty of Medina. And if you see all of them put together, he was now declaring a war against the Muslim state in Medina. That's when Rasulullah ﷺ said, enough is enough. This man has to be dealt with. And that's when Rasulullah ﷺ asked, who will be the one who will take care of Ka'ab ibn al-Ashraf? Sahabi by the name Muhammad bin Maslama radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he volunteered saying that it will be me who will take care of Ka'ab. Now Muhammad ﷺ immediately agreed. You know why? Because Muhammad bin Maslama was the chief of the Aus tribe and Ka'ab being the chief of Banu Nadir. Now, during the pre-Islamic times of the Jahiliyyah days, both these tribes were nearly one. So Ka'ab would not doubt the intention with what Muhammad bin Maslama would meet him. Muhammad bin Maslama radiallahu ta'ala anhu, as he prepares this meeting with Ka'ab, he understands the importance of this meeting because he has to win the trust and confidence of Ka'ab at any cost. This meeting will either make it or break it. So when Muhammad bin Maslama meets Ka'ab, he tells him that, you know, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam has put them under trouble by asking them to pay zakat. Because Muhammad bin Maslama knew that Ka'ab used to instigate people against paying zakat, and we mentioned the same in our previous video when we did the part one of the story. So now when Ka'ab hears something similar that Muhammad bin Maslama has come up with, he tries to take advantage of Muhammad bin Maslama and he tries to instigate Muhammad bin Maslama against Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But Muhammad bin Maslama stays calm and tells him, you know, that I've come here to borrow one or two wask of food. Now, wask is generally about 150 kgs. So Ka'ab replies saying, okay, but leave your woman behind as mortgage. Now, who on earth would ask for a woman as mortgage? Because, I mean, we just said a while back that Ka'ab used to write poems, derogatory poems, with sexual and sensual and illicit remarks in nature against Muslim women. So this shows the kind of character that Ka'ab is. This shows the kind of thoughts that run in his mind. I mean, we said earlier that he has zero respect for women. Now it shows that he has zero moral values also. But Muhammad bin Maslama, being Muhammad bin Maslama, he's the great Sahabi of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He's the Sahaba of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He stays calm, composed. He knows that he has come with an intention. He's come with a purpose. He's come with a goal to meet. So he rather puts the ball in Ka'ab's court and tells Ka'ab that, you know, you're such a handsome man living among us that we don't trust our women to be safe here. So Ka'ab says, now Muhammad bin Maslama is trying to butter him and Ka'ab doesn't realize that. And Ka'ab says, okay, then leave your children with us. Muhammad bin Maslama again very calmly replies, you know, we don't want our children to undergo constant embarrassment for the rest of their lives that they were mortgaged for few barleys. Rather, I leave my weapons with you. Now, when he says that, Ka'ab gets serious. Like, is it true that what he has heard from Muhammad bin Maslama? Because they knew the importance of the value of these weapons. These weapons were precious possessions, especially when wars were on the heads of Muslims. But let's pause and reflect the pure generosity of Muhammad bin Maslama here. That he has laid the foundation for the other Sahabas to follow the same suit, because Salkan bin Salama and Abu Naila radiallahu ta'ala anhu, may Allah be pleased with both of them, they met Ka'ab with the same intention of leaving the weapons behind. Now, Ka'ab is feeling boastful. He is feeling that he is going to handicap Muslims when these Muslims will leave the weapons behind. But they don't realize that Ka'ab has now literally invited death in his own house. That these Muslims, they will be armed to the hilt and there will be no suspicion. So on the night of 14th of Rabiul Awwal was a full moon night. Muhammad bin Maslama radiallahu ta'ala anhu, Abu Naila radiallahu ta'ala anhu, and three other Sahabas, may Allah be pleased with all of them, they set off to accomplish this task by praying to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and bidding goodbyes to their fellow companions. Now when they were inside the fortress and waiting downstairs, Abu Naila asked Ka'ab to come down. Now Ka'ab during that time was with his wife. And she immediately sensed that there is some trouble here. Because she knew that her husband was involved in targeting Muslims and he was already on hit list, and she knew that Ka'ab was inviting trouble anytime. So she sensed and she pleaded Ka'ab, you know, saying that, you know, I sense the trouble here for you because I see the rage in by which Abu Naila is asking you to come down. But Ka'ab, he tried to shoo her away by saying, you know, Abu Naila is my foster brother and I must attend his call. And without giving a second thought, rather, he was down with the Sahabas within few minutes. When Ka'ab is down with Sahabas, the Sahabas try to make him comfortable because they don't want Ka'ab to sense the intention with what they have come with. So they try to laugh around, joke around, you know, and make him comfortable. And in the midst of the conversation, they ask Ka'ab if they can walk outside the fortress to take the pleasure of walking in this beautiful moonlight, you know, and enjoy the serenity of this beautiful night. Ka'ab agrees And as they walk away from the fortress, Abu Naila, he sees this opportunity and tells Ka'ab, you know, that there's this beautiful smell coming from you. And Ka'ab replies saying that, you know, I just married the most scented woman of Arabia. And Abu Naila requests if he can smell his hand. Ka'ab agrees and he extends his hand to Abu Naila. And Abu Naila, he smells Ka'ab's hand and tells Ka'ab that this smell is coming from your hair. So by now, you know, Ka'ab is flattened by the flattering of Abu Naila, and he obliges to what Abu Naila is asking. And Abu Naila now, on pretext of smelling Ka'ab's hair, has come right behind Ka'ab, and he takes this opportunity and immediately he puts his arm around Ka'ab's neck and holds him tightly. The other Sahabas were right there. Muhammad bin Maslama, he sees what Abu Naila has done and he urges his comrades, you know, to seize this enemy of Allah. Instantly, the other Sahabas, you know, they get into the action. Muhammad bin Maslama, he strikes Ka'ab with his axe, and within few minutes, Ka'ab is flat on the ground, screaming for one final time. This rouses the guards and sends an alarm inside, but by the time they come to the scene, Sahabas have left by silencing their most staunchest enemy of Islam. And not just him, the other small enemies who were riding on the back of Ka'ab had all gone silent. The following morning, the tribe of Banu Nadir were in complete dismay because this had sent shockwaves and it was difficult for them to digest what had happened to their chief. So they went to Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam to inform him that, you know, our chief Ka'ab ibn al-Ashraf was assassinated. Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam made them sit and he made them go through every little detail of what Ka'ab was, the crimes that Ka'ab was committing and the atrocities that he had committed. Obviously, the tribe of Banu Nadir knew what Ka'ab was up to. But when they heard it from Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam mentioning to them in such minute detail, you know, their heads hang low in complete embarrassment. For they knew that Ka'ab had not just breached the constitution of Medina once or twice, but he had done it on a number of occasions. And he had virtually invited his own death. He was asking for it. So with this, alhamdulillah, we come to the end of this incident as occurred during the lifetime of Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam and as mentioned in the Seerah of Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. Jazakumullah khairan kaseera for listening to me, and if I have said something in my ignorance which I wasn't supposed to, please let me know in the comments below and I seek the forgiveness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And if you have something good in general to say, please go ahead and let me know in the comments again. I hope to see you soon inshallah. Until then, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.